Did you know that half of the top 50 games on Steam are indie titles? Or that there are only 4 fighting games with a romantic theme? Here's a fun one. Did you know that the word life appears in more game titles than death? Yet, war is mentioned twice as often as love? Today, we're diving into the data and exploring some fun insights into the game development industry. Let's start with the basics. In 2024, an average of over 70 games were released on Steam each day. A huge volume and one that's grown tremendously over the years. Around 28% of games released last year hold a positive rating today. And of those, only 2% have managed to surpass the 10,000 reviews, showing both popularity and a strong reception. For context, the fighting roguelike Sifu sits around this level. While there are some great tools available for analyzing metrics like these, they don't offer the specific data I needed for my analysis. So I had to collect it myself, directly from the source, Steam itself. And that brings us to the methodology. I'll explain it so you can see exactly how I arrived at the conclusions in this video. I started by using Steam's API to pull the full catalog of over 200,000 apps. I pulled this data mid-October 2024, so all insights are based on that timeframe. Once I had the full catalog, I wrote a script to pull data for each game, including details like its name, price, release date, and the rating and number of reviews. I used 2 endpoints from Steam, one for basic game details and another for the user reviews. I also used Steam Spy, a third-party tool with an API that estimates key metrics, like player counts for each game. To complete the picture, I used web scraping to collect game tags. This means I ran a program that navigated the entire Steam store, copying the tags for each game and saving them to a file. I found these tags especially valuable because they reflect both the developer's input and the community's influence on how the game is categorized. These scripts run for about 150 hours, that's over 6 days, gathering all the data needed for the analysis. The data from these APIs was messy and inconsistent, so I went through a systematic cleanup process. After sorting everything out, I ended up with more than 200,000 apps, roughly 140,000 of which were games or demos, each with a variety of attributes. This added up to millions of data points, so I organized everything into a database to make exploring and analyzing it much more efficient. And with that, let's dive into some interesting insights, starting with something light and fun. Here are the most common words in game titles on Steam. It's interesting to see how often certain genre names appear: adventure, simulator, shooter, and many others. There's also a lot of emphasis on fantasy themes, with words like dragon and monster popping up frequently. And certain words align with available Steam tags, like zombies and even cats. Both cat and cats made the top list, which I thought was pretty funny. Then there are some unexpected ones, like paper or cube. Not sure what's going on there. If you're aiming for a unique or memorable title for your game, maybe steer clear of the words on this list. Or maybe these words are here because they are good descriptors that resonate with players. Familiarity could be appealing too. I'll let you decide what you think about that. Next, let's dive into the data on the highest rated and lowest rated games on Steam. For the top games, I focus on titles with an overwhelmingly positive rating, sorted by the number of reviews. This ranking highlights the most popular games that maintain an excellent reputation. It's worth noting that around half of the games in the top 50 are considered indie, including hits like Terraria, Stardew Valley, Hollow Knight, Hades, Undertale, Vampire Survivors, Factorio, and Slay the Spire, to name a few. It's inspiring to see how these small teams or solo developers have created games that resonate with so many players. It's also interesting that some franchises appear more than once. For instance, both Portal and Portal 2 make the cut, as well as 2 titles from the Resident Evil series. Valve itself has an impressive presence, with 6 games in the top 50. The only other developers with multiple entries are SCS Software, Larian Studios, and Capcom, with 2 titles each. At the other end of the spectrum, we have the lowest rated games. Remarkably, only 12 games on Steam have an overwhelmingly negative score. Even the least reviewed of these has more than 500 reviews, meaning all of them have a substantial base of feedback. I reviewed each title to understand why they performed so poorly. The game with the lowest score, War of the Three Kingdoms, is a 2021 release with nearly 60,000 reviews, filled with complaints about everything from lack of localization to gameplay issues, lag, aggressive monetization, and accusations against the company's integrity. In several of these low-ranked games, players felt misled or scammed by paying for what they perceived as unfinished or poorly executed projects, Many of these games also face severe technical problems, with frequent mentions of bugs and crashes. Interestingly, some of these titles were spin-offs of otherwise well-regarded series, like Command & Conquer, Airline Tycoon, and Flatouts. Then there's Uriel's Chasm, which earned kind of a cool status for its bizarre, chaotic gameplay that most players found impossible to enjoy. There's much to learn from both top-rated and low-rated games alike. With that, let's move into discussing untapped opportunities and unique ideas for games. I was curious whether there are combinations of genres or other properties that are still underexplored. For instance, are there any rhythm-based shooters out there? What about games that combine sports with a sci-fi setting? To explore this, I turned to data from Steam tags. Steam offers a total of 447 predefined tags, which are added by both developers and players. I organized these tags further, subdividing them into categories based on my own interpretation to better analyze potential patterns. I first focus on combinations of two genres, to identify original or underexplored ideas. To keep the results meaningful, I only included games with more than 10 reviews and focus on the most popular genres, excluding the extremely niche ones that would add unnecessary noise. Each point on the graph represents a pair of genres. On the horizontal axis, I plotted the number of games in at least one of the two genres. This gives an idea of the individual popularity of the genres. If one of them is strong, the number goes up, and if both are popular, the plot point will end up on the far right. On the vertical axis, we see how many games are tagged with both genres simultaneously, which shows the opportunities. The lower the point, the more novel the combination, as fewer games share both genres. In summary, the most interesting opportunities are the ones that are farther down to the right, where both genres are popular but the combination is rare. For example, there are only 3 platformer automators, and none seem particularly well known. There are 14 card game shooters, with Friends vs. Friends being the most famous, which I hadn't heard of before but it looks pretty fun. Then there are just 3 rhythm-based tower defense games. I could probably spend hours analyzing this graph. Instead, I'll link an interactive version in the video description so you can explore other combinations on your own, and move on to talk about themes. The most common themes in games are fairly predictable, with a strong focus on fantasy and sci-fi settings. This is reflected in the frequent use of words like magic, monsters, space, or worlds in the titles of many games. Focusing on the 20 most popular themes, I explored combinations of these with different genres. With the top genres, it seems nearly all themes are well explored. Keep in mind though that not all themes have tags on Steam, so there's a selection bias at play. A few combinations stand out. There are only 4 romance fighting titles, with Troublemaker being the most well known. While this pairing might not attract the typical audience, there's definitely a niche for players who enjoy both. Another interesting combination is cooking games in a sci-fi setting, with around 10 games. In fact, on closer inspection, not all of these are truly cooking games. Some include cooking only as a feature. But the idea of, say, running a hot dog stand on an alien planet has a playful charm. So these combinations can definitely spark new ideas. Finally, I also reviewed genre combinations with tags related to dimensions, like 2D and 3D, and perspectives, like first person and third person. But it's probably best if you explore the data yourself. I'll link to all of these charts. One trend worth noting though is the steady rise in 3D releases. New 3D titles are now being launched almost as frequently as 2D ones. Let's take a brief pause from discussing video game genres to explore female and LGBTQ+ representation within the data. Around 10% of games on Steam are tagged with female protagonist, a number that seems surprisingly low. I had expected this percentage to show a steady growth over the years, but interestingly the trend isn't so clear. In contrast, LGBTQ+ representation shows a much clearer upward trend, with tagged games tripling in proportion over the past decade. The oldest title with this tag is Secret of the Magic Crystals from 2010, a game about breeding horses, I think. Moving on, let's dive into a specific genre of games that has piqued my interest as a player over the last few years. Card games, particularly roguelike deck builders. My favorite game in this genre, and perhaps even in general, is Slay the Spire. I've always thought it is a well-crafted fusion of genres, and I have often wondered if it was the catalyst for the rise of roguelike deck builders. By the way, as a quick side note, it seems roguelikes are significantly more popular in the indie scene compared to the AAA catalog. Platformers show a similar pattern, representing a much larger portion of indie games. Now, returning to roguelike deck builders in particular, I structured my analysis based on a framework from a study I found, which I think is excellent. I'll link that study and other references in the video description if you'd like to dive deeper. This graph shows the proportion of games on Steam that can be classified as roguelike deck builders over the past 10 years. This is based on game tags. Some of them are really helpful in pinpointing this subgenre. It's clear that Slay the Spire had a massive influence. Its release in January 2019 sparked a significant rise in the number of games in this category. And in less than 5 years, the genre's presence in the Steam catalog grew by 5 times. When we examine the popularity of these games, measured by review counts, we see that while the genre has grown, most titles still remain relatively niche, accumulating fewer than 100 reviews. However, there are some standout successes, like Inscription and Balatro. Interestingly, the red dot in the graph represents War of the Three Kingdoms, the lowest rated game on Steam, which we discussed earlier. For those of you who are as hooked on this genre as I am, I've put together a graph showcasing some of the best roguelike deck builders out there. These are the 20 games that balance both user rating and popularity the best. I've played many of them and can confirm they are fantastic. The rest will likely be my next addiction. If you have suggestions for other analysis, questions about the methodology, or if you spot any errors, feel free to reach out on Discord or in the comments. I'll update the description or maybe the pinned comment with any corrections based on your feedback. It was really fun to dive into this data, and I hope you found it interesting. See you next time.